Hello students, hope you all are doing well. So here in this session we are going to talk about indicators. It's the lesson indicators that we are going to talk here about. What is an indicator? Do you know what an indicator is? Indicators by its name simply are the things which indicate. Who indicate things are indicators. In your research, you have indicators indicating the seconds, minutes, hours, the time. You have various meters indicating various scales, various values. So you have different types of indicators being used in day-to-day activities. There will be various different indicators that you are having the support with. So in the same way, in ours here, the context is titration. Hope you could remember that our earlier lesson, it was titrations, right? We were talking about titrations. Then thereafter, it was titration curves that we talked about. Okay, let me recall your memory. A titration is a method, an activity that used to find out the volume of a certain species need to react with a certain volume of another species. So, in other words, it's finding out of the volume that contains the number of moles need to react exactly with the number of moles of the other species in a certain volume. So if you use titration class, burette, film those two reagents into each. So you did the titration and then slowly the burette reagent on the titration class reagent. So when you notice, when you found out, it is the end of the reaction. You stopped the tap of the burette, thinking it's the end of the reaction. Anyway, it was the required moment that those two reagents, number of moles, are exactly in the amounts that they need to be according to the stoichiometry. Was the moment we require. We call that the equivalence point. Good evening. It is equivalence point what we expect. Let's say theoretical. Then anyway, when we observe it's the end of the reaction, thinking it's what we need, we have reached what we need, we stop the time. So that practical moment we reach is called the end point. So what we expect is, what our expectations are actually is just to be, may our equilibrium point, equivalence point, the end point that we get, means it is what we get as the end point, may be our equivalence point. It's we do not just wish, but we work on that to bring our end point at least close to the equivalence point. Okay, anyway, when we receive the message that reaction is now over, stop the tap, the reaction is over, and that message, when we get that, we stop the tap. Who sends that message? Who gives that message? Who tells that? Stop the tap. It's the indicator. That is an indicator. So in our context, in titrations, the species that we use there are as to get the end point, get the signal that the reaction now is over, is the indicator that species is the indicator. So we are doing various reactions, various titrations, categories I would say, acid base, redox. In all of those, we could use indicators when it requires. So it's in redox titrations. When you are having potassium dichromate, you could use diphenyl amine as the indicator. When you are having iodine involved titrations, like we call iodometric titrations, then you could use starch as the indicator. So in acid-based titrations, you might have heard of many indicators being used, like methyl orange, phenolphthalein, bromothymone blue, phenol red, congo red. Many indicators you might have heard of them. Okay, they all are the same, means they all are doing one duty. They are in titration. They send a message. They mention that it's the end of the reaction. They tell that stop the tap. So indicators indicate the end point. Anyway, if they change something, it's mostly color that in our colorimetry. So indicators, otherwise if it is a pH change you are waiting for, so the pH meters reading is the indicator. So anyway, so then when we do normal our titration, it's the color change we expect, we wait for. Therefore indicators, they change their colors at the end of the reaction, any of those. So then it's seeing or feeling a difference in the medium. So being sensitive to the difference in the medium, when you keep adding the reagent from the burette, then in the titration class there will be a composition and environment. That environment, chemical environment, they are in the medium would change with the time. So when it is totally opposite, totally other way, it would switch to the other color, an indicator. That's what an indicator is. It at least has two different colors. It could be more than two as well. Anyway, its students, we were talking about acid-based titrations a lot, right? So therefore, let's find out these indicators function, action, based on acid-based titrations. But it's, you shouldn't forget that it's the same, it's common that the function of an indicator for redox titrations as well. Okay, we are going to start talking about acid-based titrations. Students, hope you will remember the last drawn titration curves. So, they have got this common way of changing the pH. There was a sudden drop of pH when it was the end of the reaction. So, was the time we stopped the tap, so the end point. Actually, indicators told us it's the end point. So anyway, what I needed to tell you was there would be a change in its environment in the titration class. The change here during acid-based titrations is the pH change. Whatever they are, we use as the indicator, need to be sensitive for the pH change. Who would be sensitive for pH change? It's either weak acids or weak base. Okay. Students, it's in acid-based titrations that we use as indicators are either it could be a weak acid or a weak base. Don't get confused. Then you think like in acid-base titrations, you are titrating an acid against the base or other way. Then if you are using an indicator also in an acid or a base, that also could involve in the reaction and interfere that, and it could affect our accuracy, could affect our accuracy, intervene there. It's actually not, let me explain that. Explain to you how indicators work, serves, they are giving the signal. Okay, I'll show you. It's again, I'm repeating that, it's either a weak acid or a weak base. Just being a weak acid or a weak base is not still enough, not still qualified to be an indicator. To be an indicator, it needs to have two different colors at least. Okay. It needs to have two different colors, that one would be exhibiting in its acidic media, other color would be exhibiting in its basic medium. Then these two different colors need to be noticeable, means one apart from other. If they are close colors, then it's not a good indicator. So you need to be able to identify them differently. It's this color, it's the other color, like that. Okay. Then I'm going to use a model as my indicator. I'm going to use a weak acid as my indicator. My indicator here is a weak acid. Shall I use the model? It's an indicator. So I will take Im from that. It's a weak acid. So shall I use my model as HIM? HIM. Okay. Students, HIM is my model that I am going to use as my indicator. So you would see this. It's either a weak acid or weak base. Here it's a weak acid. So it's a weak, therefore it could separate or dissociate partially into H plus and Im minus. This is the weak acid here in this context. It could be even a weak base as well. Then this is the conjugated base. Of the weak acid, when an acid loses its proton, after that the remaining part is called the conjugated base of the respective acid. It's the same on bases as well. When a base gives out OH minus, the remaining part is called the conjugated acid of the weak base. Okay. So it's then, students, if you have this being the indicator, it's a weak acid, but to be an indicator, these particles, these weak acid particles need to have one color, and these conjugated base particles need to have the other opposite color, different color. So it's, shall I call this red? Red, the color here for my example. So then the other color, shall I call it blue here in my example. Then students, when you have these particles in the medium, you would find the medium being red. When you have these particles in the medium, you would find the medium being blue. So it's an equilibrium, it's a reversibility to reach equilibrium. So you would have both particles. When you have both particles in equal amounts, you will find the intermediate color. Then you can't call it either red or blue. The intermediate is called purple. Okay, so anyway, when you have more red colored particles than blue colored particles, it is like in a medium. medium, when you have more red color particle, if this is the medium, there, if you have more red color particles, still having less blue color particles, the medium would appear in red. When you have a medium having more blue colored particles, but less red colored particles, the medium would appear in blue. So the dominant species would give the color to the medium. That is one thing, one important thing, one point. So then, let me explain this. When you have the medium being acidic, means more protons you have in the medium, means more H plus. When you have more H plus, here this is my indicator, use model indicator. So it's, if it is at equilibrium, when you have more H plus in the medium, so the equilibrium point would shift left according to the later years principle. What's that? When you have more and more H plus, backward direction would be more favored. So with increase of H plus, it is more favored, the backward, so it would lesser the number of Im minus particles there. Therefore the Im minus concentration. When you have low Im minus concentration and more HIM concentration, you would have the medium in red. Medium having more of these particles would appear in red. It is when you have protons, you have medium being acidic. Therefore, it is the acidic color standing for this indicator. Then what's the other way? When the medium is basic, means you have more and more OH minus. In the other hand, you have less H plus. When the H plus concentration is less, this would be very low, so it would then favor the forward direction according to Leclerc principle. Leclerc principle says that when you have one concentration being lesser, so the direction that it gives more of that concentration would be more favored. Actually, what he is having, the backward direction's rate would be lowered compared to the forward direction rate. Therefore, the forward direction would be followed more and more. So, you would find more Im minus particles as the result at the end of that. When you have more Im minus particles, the medium would appear in blue. It is blue, more blue colored particles. So the concentration of Im minus particle is high, greater compared to Im particles. So the medium would appear in blue. It is having when the medium is basic. So blue color is the basic color for this indicator. Basic color. Okay, that's what simply is. When you have medium being acidic, you would have the acidic color for the reason that HIM, weak acid particles, would, the concentration of them would get increased. So when you have less H plus in the medium, so the conjugated base particle would be more, therefore the medium would appear in the basic color. That's why when the medium is acidic, acidic color would be given. The medium is basic color would be given. This is the way, this reversibility is the reason for giving those colors. Then, if I could write an expression for this equilibrium using an equilibrium constant. This is the weak acid, so the equilibrium constant is Ka. But it is, here we are talking about indicators, so I am going to use it as KI for this very special moment. It's my indicator, that's all. So indicators, equilibrium constant, I will write it as, it's the same Ka expression. So H plus concentration into Im minus concentration, not Mi, In minus concentration, it is HIN concentration. This is what? Could you remember that we have derived Anderson-Hasselbalch equation? Okay. It's, we could next, at next time, we could multiply both sides by minus log. KIN, other side the asterisk, minus log. H plus concentration, IN minus concentration, divided by HIN concentration. So, I could split it here using the log rule, log xy equals log x plus log y. It's this. If it is log xy, you are having, you could split that into log x plus log y. Similarly, I am going to split it here. So, it's, I'm going to write log minus log k IN b equals minus log. I need this h plus alone and minus log IN minus concentration divided by HIN concentration. So I could, if it is minus log, I would give p on this. So it is pk IN. So it is pH minus log. Still the same, IN minus concentration divided by HIN concentration. So I'm going to make that in subject pH. So it is PKIN plus log IN minus concentration divided by HIN concentration. It's the same Anderson-Hasselbalch equation that you have derived earlier. For K, HA, it was A minus divided by HA. So it's the same one, Anderson-Hasselbalch equation. Then, its students deriving that what I expected was actually to show you some limits of seeing colors. Okay, let me explain that. Hope it's clear to you. Then next I'm going to erase this. So in general, it is believed this fact that in general, a healthy human could recognize the medium only in one color when that colored particle's concentration is either 10 times or more than of the other colored particles. What is that? It is, students, when you have more particles here in the medium. It is when you have one particle's concentration being either 10 times than the other, as of the other, or greater than of that, then the medium could be seen or could be identified in that color only. It's for a healthy human eye. For a healthy person, the medium could be seen in red. When the concentration of these HIA is greater than of that, not only greater than of that, is 10 times as of that, is 10 times as of that, or greater than of that. Could be seen in red only, means normally within this range, when you have it being either 10 times, these red particles being 10 times or greater, means 100 times, 1000 times, then also it's red. So the other way also is the same. So to see the medium, I have erased this, so to see the
It has to be In minus concentration now is greater than of HIN concentration as it's either 10 times or greater than of that. These are the limits. But it actually depends on the person as well as the color. Some colors are noticeable means you could see one apart from others so easily than others. Its intensity also affects. So, its students, then I am going to use these limits in my derived expression. So, it's this. It's when the medium is seen in red. So, it's, you need to satisfy this condition. HIN concentration divided by IN minus has to be equals to 10 or greater than that. So, other way is, it's for the reason I have what? IN minus divided by HIN in that equation, that's why. So, it has to be 1/10. The other way, 1 over that. 1/10 or this need to be greater than of this means when this is greater the value would be lesser. So it has to be in this way. Then students, when I apply it here in my derived expression, pH needs to be equal to pKa plus log IN minus HIN, right? HIN. So for that I am going to substitute pKa plus log 1/10. So 1/10 means this 10 comes up and it is 10 to the power minus 1. Log 10 to the power minus 1 is minus 1. So it is pH going to be equals pKIN minus 1. This is the value. So it shows that at least when the pKIN value that you are having, when the pKIN value minus 1, when the pH in the medium is having that value, when you have a certain pKIN value, then one pH unit down to that. When the medium's pH is that pH or further lesser pH only, it's showing you red color here, acidic color. And to see the acidic color, medium in red means acidic color. So, you need to have a pH being this or lesser than of that. That's the limit. Then, you need to check for the pKIN value of an indicator. Then, one pH unit down that value, down to that, lower to that. So, then, having that pH or further lesser pH in the medium, only you would be able to see the medium in acidic color. It's actually a rough estimated thing. We assume that the healthy human eye behaves in a way like that, but it depends on the person. Okay. Anyway, it's a rough idea. So, I could do the same thing on basic color as well. So, I am going to erase this. If students, to see the medium in the basic color means in blue, to see the medium in blue, the basic color, you need to have IN minus being more than of HIA, at least 10 times or greater than of that. So, it's, I'm having this change in that equation, so it is pH equals pKa minus plus its log IN minus concentration divided by HIN concentration. So, I would write this there straightly, it is pH pKa log. At least I need to have this log 10, it is 10 to the power 1, it is plus 1. It is pKa plus 1, the pH. When you have the pH in the medium being 1 unit above the pKa, then it could appear in blue. Or further, means or greater than of that. So, then also it's blue. Then students, the idea is, it's unhaving two colors within the range of this. It's, if this is the indicators, HIN indicators, PKIN, somewhere you have. It depends on the indicator that you are having. For sometimes it is a weak acid, for some other times it is a weak base. Therefore, it could vary based on the type of the indicator you are taking. So it's minus 1 means down. From here, down there you would have the medium in red. It's plus 1 here, the limit above, either this or above that, it would appear in blue. So, in between you have concentrations like those are close concentrations. It's 1s to 1, 1s to 2, 1s to 3, 1s to 4, 1s to 5, 1s to 6, or 2s to 1, 3s to 1, or such. Then it's a mixed color. It's a mixed color. Shall I call it purple? Or intermediate color. Intermediate color. So, then this point is very important. Indicators are good at showing colors at certain pH values only. It's at certain pH means there would be a limit standing for an indicator. Below that limit only it would be showing its acidic color. Below that limit means you would have a medium having certain pH. When the medium's pH is below the limit, this limit of the indicator, then indicator being there in that medium would exhibit its acidic color. If the same indicator is there in a solution in a medium of which the pH is above this limit, then this same indicator would be showing its basic color. That's how indicators do their functions. So, therefore, it's very, very important knowing this range. An indicator would have its own range. We call that the indicator's range. Indicator's range. So, we need to know, regarding an indicator, we need to know the indicator's range. For an example, its spinocular would have 8.3 to 10. It's not all the times exactly 1 unit, another unit, 2 units difference. It depends on the color as well as the type of indicator. So, it's therefore, for phenolphthalein, it is 8.3 to 10 roughly. So, it is methyl orange, would be having 3.2 to 4.1 or such. Its bromothymol blue would be having 6 to 7.6 roughly. Its range, indicators are having their ranges. Then, indicators are having their pKIN values as well. Therefore, regarding an indicator, you need to know these details. What's the pKIN of that indicator? As well as, what's the indicator's range, what's the pH range that it exhibits? Its basic color and acidic color, two colors. Then, in between, the medium having in between pH, it would be showing an intermediate color. Then students, you need to know the acidic color of an indicator and the basic color of the indicator. Okay, let me show you
few such details regarding few known indicators. Let's find that out. Okay, here you have few indicators being given. So you could find the indicator is PKI value, pH range as the color, basic color. Standing for few, here six are given. So the methyl orange, you could find its PKI value is 3.7. So you have this pH range standing for the indicator range. So as the color is red, basic color is yellow. So this is the next important one, is the phenolphthalein. 9.3 the PKIN is 8.2 and 10 colors, pink or red you could say. It's bromothymol blue, we could call it BTB as well, BTB. So it's having PKIN between 7 and 6 to 7.6 is the pH range, so it's yellow and blue. So you have others also having some sort of certain PKIN values and indicate ranges, acidic colors, basic colors. Its students, you need to know these three indicators, including methyl red also, it's better if you know. So then these at least few indicators you need to know about. So with their range, it's no need to buy hard this value, but you need to know a rough range standing for each, and its acidic color as well as basic color. So regarding first few indicators, you need to know those details. Then let's find out how could we use these indicators knowledge, the indicator range and its PKI value on determination of endpoints in our different types of titration. Let's find that out. Okay, we have four different types of acid-based titrations. Hope you could remember. Strong acid, strong base titration, strong acid, weak base titration, weak acid, strong base titrations, and the last was weak acid, weak base titration. So, in students, we drew those titration curves for each type, and it's we found out rough pH range at the endpoint standing for strong acid, strong base 4 to 10, strong acid, weak base 4 to 7, weak acid, strong base 7 to 10. And for weak acid, weak base, there was no such clear range. It was the titration range. Did they are in the last session, last video. So let me recall your memory regarding that. If it was strong acid, strong base, you could find them starting at a very high limit level and falling down to a very low pH. So we roughly took that as 4 to 10, roughly. But it was with high concentration, it was not that, but roughly under narrow conditions, giving minimum facilities. So it is strong acid, strong base titration. So for strong acid, weak base, if the acid is strong, it gone to a very low. It has gone to a very low. So then if it is weak, the base, so it is roughly, we could give it as 4 to 7. It was 4. This is the pH. This is the volume of the acid added from the burette. So this is the strong acid, weak base, titration curve. So the next one was weak acid, strong base. So if the base is strong, it started at very high, and if the acid is weak, so it did not go that low. So rough value range was taken as 7 to 10. So, it is for strong, weak acid, strong base titrations. Titration curve, titrations.
titration curve. So then for the last, it was weak, the base, so did not started from a very high, so at the end it did not go to a very low, so it was not that clear the range. There was no such clear range to be seen. For weak, both weak acid, weak base titration, titrations. Hope you will remember these from the last video, last lesson. So, its students, if you are having an indicator would be having its own indicator range, then if this is the indicator, this is, if this is the PKIN of the indicator, there would be an indicator range. So, it's you could use that indicator on determination of endpoint if this sudden pH fall drop here, it's not clear. So that drop, you could find that confining this range indicator. What I mean was, if you are using an indicator, that indicator's range need to fit within this range. Then only you could determine the endpoint. You could recognize, it's over. You could see a color change. Say that you have an indicator having its indicator range here. So students, it's you would be adding your acid from the burette. So then starting at the very beginning, it would be basic color. It's slowly decreasing the pH here. So it turns to the intermediate color. But then after it goes to the acidic color, unknowingly, means it's not clear where it reaches the acidic color, where it was the end of the basic color, where it was the actual intermediate color. And the other thing is, then seeing a color change here after this, it's actually what we get is not the exact moment. What we need is the equivalence point. For these titrations, this is the equivalence point. It's the midpoint of that titration range. You get the equivalence point. So what we do in titration, what we expect is to reveal, find out the equivalence point. But you can't reveal the equivalence point using indicators not lying its indicator range within this range. You can't. So if you use an indicator, it's a must to be found its indicators indicate range within this range. So as you know, phenolphthalein could be used here, though I have mentioned phenolphthalein's upper limit is 10, though I have given it as 10 for strong acid chrome based titrations, it could be quite above the 10. So therefore you could use phenolphthalein to determine the endpoint here. Hereafter you would be adding a droplet, so then by that droplet pH will drop. When it drops, it turns from till this level, this limit, it is giving its basic color. So for all these droplets, it's still till you add these all, the medium still is basic. So it's then till the medium is appearing in pink or red. So thereafter, after this droplet, it quickly goes, it falls to this. So then it's pink to colorless. The color could be seen changing by one or few droplets. So then that's a good indicator could be used for these titrations. Not only that, you could use methyl orange as well. Methyl orange, its indicator range also fits here within this range. Therefore, you could use either phenolphthalein or methyl orange.
it's not only though that those two, it's but also you could use volatile blue acid. It is 6 to 7.6 the range, so you could use that also as a suitable indicator. So then it's the broadest range you would find there. Stood for strong acid, strong base titration, for 10 the range was. So any indicator that fits its indicators range within this range could be used as suitable indicator for these type of titrations. So there are many indicators, therefore you would use for the broadest range is shown by strong base titrations. Therefore, students, when you are about to select an indicator standing for HCl-NaOH titration, it's out of many you would decide to take any that lies within this range, that its indicators range lies within this range. Any indicator out of many of those given, you would select. Then regarding this, it's you can't use phenolphthalein here. Phenolphthalein's indicator range is lying here. So it's you could use either methyl orange or BTB. Either methyl orange or methyl red. Okay, for these titrations, you could use methyl red or methyl orange. So then it's on these kind of titrations, it's you could use phenolphthalein, because its indicator range fits here, not methyl orange or methyl red you could use. Then on these kind of titrations, it's no clear titration range could be seen. Therefore, you can't use an indicator. For that reason, it's you can't do a titration between these. For the reason there is no suitable indicator could be used, you can't do. Okay, again, it's many indicators out of methyl orange, methyl red, phenolphthalein, bromothymol blue, all of those are suitable indicators for the broadest range giving titration, strong acid, strong base titrations. Then for this type, it's methyl orange, methyl red could be used. For this type, it's phenolphthalein could be used. For this type, it's you can't find an indicator for the reason there is no such range or titration range pH drop being given. Okay, then it is a competition between indicators. Indicators would compete as I would be the suitable one, I would be the most suitable one. Then when you decide which indicator is the most suitable one, it's based on two contexts you would decide the best fit, most suitable indicator. Students, if you are not that sure of your range, if it is having a risk of narrowing further, then it's not better taking the indicators having their ranges at the margins here and there. It's the best fit having the indicator here that fits to the very mid, having its pK Ig value of the indicator being the same or close to the equivalence point pH, and its indicators to range to values limits lying at two sides of the equivalence point pH. Okay, so when you check for the best fit, most suitable indicator, if it is not that certain, if it is having a risk of narrowing more the titration range, it's better using the indicator having its indicator range at the mid of the titration range, as its pKIn value being equal or close to the equivalence point pH value, as well as lying at those two limits of indicator's range lying at the two sides of equivalence point pH is the best case. Therefore, in that context, for strongest and strongest titrations, the best fit or most suitable is the VTV. There is another context as well. In this context, it could be in practice, it could be, though we draw it in this manner, this curve would not be that sudden drop. It could be a bit slant in a way like this. So it would not take just one drop, but few drops. So if you are considering, if your concern is now about the accuracy, it's better taking using the indicator that its indicator range is very close to the start of the pH drop. So it's regarding the accuracy. When you are not having that kind of risk of narrowing further the titration range, when it is quite certain the titration range, then when your concern is on the accuracy, when you are having that the pH fall at the end point being taken not one drop but few droplets, means it's not consuming one drop only but few droplets if it is taking the end point, then it's more accurate using the indicator, having its indicator's range at the very beginning of pH drop. So within that. So in that context, for these kind of titrations, phenolphthalein is the best fit. It depends on the context, what you need, your requirement. So as it satisfies your requirement, you could decide which one is the best indicator to be used for a titration. Then students, it's now you could see the purpose of learning titration curves and about indicators. We then combine those two knowledges, two ideas of indicator's function with the titration curve. Then we know how to select an indicator for a titration and how to select the most suitable indicator for a titration. So, hope you would understand these things. It's in our next effort, next video, we are going to talk about carbonate bicarbonate titrations. Let's check how those are going to vary or how those would be followed based on the indicator used. Okay students, we are going to wound up here. So we'll meet in our next video talking about carbonate bicarbonate titrations. Okay, bye bye.